All right, so let's start with this session, right? So I'd like to welcome everybody who's here for taking out the precious time and who's here for this session on Ensemble Learning by GreyAtom. I am Loveesh Bhatt, and I am working as a senior data scientist with Pitney Bowes. I have around a decade of experience into analytics. I've been into machine learning and deep learning for the past 5-6 years. And I have extensive experience in training models, putting them into production, and evaluating how it is affecting the business. So especially from the time when we are talking about the inception of the model to the time when we are deploying the model and getting outcomes, real world outcomes from the model, that's where my contribution comes into picture. Now I'm not aware if we have people in the audience who are a little bit who have a little bit of know-how of how machine learning works. So I'm presuming that everybody here is coming with a clean slate. So I'll begin with the starting off with what Ensemble Learning is, right? So let's get into this. So when we are talking about machine learning, right, what we are actually doing in machine learning is we are using some data, right, to train a machine to learn a particular kind of a behavior. So that's, that's a one-liner that can define machine learning in brief. Now, what happens here is, so there's nothing in the chat. So we have to be aware of this fact that as long as there is a pattern in the data, then only machine will be able to learn it. So it's very essential for you to understand the intuition behind the problem that you're working. And if you feel that, when you're looking at the data, you're doing the feature engineering, feature exploration part, where you're, looking at the variables, looking at different trends in the variables, just by doing that exploratory part, you'll be able to figure out whether this will make a good model or not, right? So as long as you can figure that there's a pattern in the data, then only machine will be also be able to figure. The only difference between us and the machines is that we are able to visualize things in three dimensions, but the machines are able to do it in multi-dimensional space. And going beyond three dimensions is very complex for us, but for machines, it's not that tough. But again, the intuition behind how to solve a machine learning problem is really important, right? So Ensemble Learning, as the name suggests, come from two words. One is Ensemble and the other is learning. Now, Ensemble is a very common word that people hear in, when they are talking about orchestra or when they are talking about some musical concerts where different instruments come together and make a melody, right? So that's the same thing exactly that we are trying to do here also in machine learning, right? We are trying to bring together different models, combine them in such a way so that we can get some predictions, so that we get better predictions than our traditional methods. And learning is a term that is actually derived from your machine learning part, where we are using the data, the training data, to train a mathematical function which can essentially help you make decisions and drive outcome for the businesses. Okay, so now typically when we're talking about Ensemble Learning, as I told you, right, we're combining multiple weak learners to make better predictions. So in layman terms, what we can say is that we're combining multiple models and using their predictions together to get better predictions and better outcomes. Now, this can be done primarily using three ways. One is called bagging. One second, I'll just enable the pen. Okay, I'm not sure if I'll probably have to do it this way, because I cannot script with the pen on that screen. I think I'll be able to do it here. Right, so when we're talking about Ensemble Learning, we're typically talking about three methods. One is bagging, then you have boosting, and then you have stacking. Now, the most popular method in the last decade or so has been models like random forest, who generally use decision trees, different decision trees, and combine and make a prediction on top of that. So those models, especially random forest, is a very classic example of bagging, where you're using homogeneous models to make predictions. So by homogeneous models, I mean that there is only one decision tree that we're talking about. So basically random forest is nothing but multiple decision trees put together. So there's some issue with the pen here. Yeah. So a random forest is basically multiple decisions combined together. So it is decision trees put together, and those decision trees make predictions. And so we'll get into the random forest in much more detail. We'll also do a case study on random forest, and we'll try and understand how does random forest actually work and why is it beneficial over traditional techniques like a decision tree or a simple classification algorithm like a logistic regression, right? So that comes under bagging. Now let's talk about the other method, which is the boosting. Boosting again combines weak learners. They are again homogeneous weak learners. That means an algorithm like XGBoost or AdaBoost will use boosted trees to make predictions. And these predictions will again be made from a single modeling methodology, right? So that's why we are calling it homogeneous learners. These are all homogeneous learners. That means we are not combining different modeling techniques to do boosting. The difference between bagging and boosting primarily is that boosting works with the errors that your model makes. So when you train a particular model, a weak learner will definitely make those errors. The next iteration of the model will be trained on those errors that the previous model had made, right? So that's how boosting works, and it typically using boosted trees refines your predictions or brings down the error with each iteration. So I will be touching upon boosting with an example, a short example, just to build the intuition behind how boosting really works. And then let's move on to the next part, which is the stacking. Now, stacking is where the homogeneity is kept aside, right? So here we are basically using non-homogeneous models and using those models to feed into a meta model, essentially a deep net or something like that to make predictions, right? So I'll be also touching upon, not in very much length on stacking, but I'll be taking a simple example to explain how stacking really works. So let's start by looking at bagging, right? The technique that we are talking about, which is the random forest. So if I move to the next slide, you'll see a nice classy car. This is a Lamborghini Veneno, my favorite. So that's the reason it is here. And one of the reasons I've used this car and this example to explain ensemble learning is because it will help you picturize things in a much better way. Because if I go into the mathematical and the statistical part of things, it might seem a little overwhelming. So the idea here is to build the intuition and make you less intimidated with techniques like ensemble learning and machine learning in general. So let's say that tomorrow you figure out that you have to buy a car. It might not be a Lamborghini Veneno, but if you have to buy a car, you have some areas which you will look at, right? So when you go out to buy a car, you'll probably you have different avenues to look for, right? So you'll go to a salesperson, you'll talk with the salesperson. They will give you information about the internal functionality of the car, how the car is in terms of the power, what features does it give you, and basically what a salesperson tells you about a car. Now, that is one set of information that you'll get, right? But you never rely on one set of information. You always go online, check reviews, right? So you'll probably go to a website like AutoCar, check the online review and see, how it has done in the past. Let's say if in the 5 years that the car has been in the market, how it has fared in the market over those 5 years. So you'll look at that information also, right? Along with that, let's say if one of your friends has a car, right, has the same car, you'll probably talk to them also. So that's a third set of information that you bring in. And when you combine all this information together, what you get is a holistic, holistic view of how the car performs, right? So it's not just a biased view, right? It's not just a view of a salesman who's trying to sell his car, who's trying to meet his targets. So it's not like that. It's all the three information combined together for the best decision that you can make. Now, that is what ensemble learning basically is, right? It basically gives you information from different domains or different models, and then that information is combined together to make a better decision that probably will not happen when you're using a single model. Now, that's what I said, right? It's a diverse set of learners, individual models that we are using to make these predictions. Okay, so now the case is, why do we need ensemble models? Now, this is where we need to understand that the intuition behind ensemble models is far, far more enriching than a typical traditional model. Now let's try and understand a typical, a simple use case, right? Where we are trying to do a classification problem. So let's say, I have X and Y, right? I'm trying to predict Y, which is my dependent variable, and X is my independent variable. So, let's just talk about two variables, for the sake of simplicity. Now I have a case where I have X's, right? And I have zeros. Now, if I have to classify this problem, right, it is pretty simple. I just draw a line and I can identify X's here and zeros here. And, even if there is one X here and one zero here, it does not really cause much of a problem for me. But let's say you have another case, right, where you have X and Y, right? And your data looks something like this. Right, you can train a polynomial regression model and find out, that this is the best fit line that probably suits, this kind of a classification technique. But now the data that you have trained this on, right? So these data points that I've drawn over here, they are all your training data set, right? So in machine learning, what we generally do is we basically divide data into two parts. One is the training model. One is the training data, and then there's the test data. The proportion generally stays around 70 to 30, 80 to 20. And when you're using this training data to train the model, and you're training a model which is so precise that it is able to gather the nuances also, in such a way that it is a highly nonlinear model that is able to learn the patterns here. The resultant of this could be devastating because of the fact that you have used training data to train this model, and you have overfitted your model onto this this guy, right? This training data. So if test data tomorrow, you check the data, accuracy and precision recall, all the metrics that are used to evaluate these models, you'll figure that, your model is not really doing well on your test data. And whenever you're putting it into production, what you'll realize is that whenever you're making predictions on a model which is trained highly, specific to a data set, it will always give you errors on the actual real life data, because your real life data might not be organized like that. It might be close to this, but it can be really, really, really different from this also. So in that case, a model like this, which is allowing a few violations here and there, will always fare better than a typical polynomial, highly nonlinear regressive model. Now, this is where ensemble learning comes into picture, right? So let's say I have a decision tree. Now, when I'm talking about a decision tree, this problem that I'm talking about, which is called overfitting, is a big problem with decision trees, right? Because the decision trees can grow up to a really large depth, and they can capture a lot of nuances. Decision trees are really good at learning non-linear patterns. And that's the reason decision trees tend to overfit a lot of times, right? Because they're learning a highly non-linear pattern on the training data, but when it comes to making predictions on the test data, they fall off course. So, that's the reason the motivation for ensemble models came into picture, right? Now, what ensemble learning does when we are talking about, let's say a bagging kind of technique, which we'll be doing in much more detail. So let's look at, let's try and understand bias and variance, right? So bias and variance is what I explained in the previous slide itself. So when I'm talking about variance, right? So variance is essentially the part where we're saying that it is highly overfitting, right? So if your model has high variance, that means it is overfitting your training data. So the accuracy in the test data falls drastically. And if the accuracy on the test data is not really good, that means essentially, your model is like a good for nothing model. Now the bias part is where we are talking about underfitting. So bias is where we're talking about underfitting. So underfitting is basically opposite of overfitting, right? So when I said that you're overfitting your data, let's say by x, 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 you have a zero here, you have a zero here, and you have an x here, you have a zero here. So if you're learning your pattern like this, this is basically a typical case of overfitting. But if I draw a decision boundary, which is, you know, which is not able to differentiate between X's and zeros at all, right? So in the previous slide, we saw that there were some violations that were allowed across the decision boundary. But if you have a model which is not able to learn any patterns, right? So let's say this is the decision boundary that your model has learned. So it is clearly a underfitting case, right? Where you're not able to make correct predictions for either the class X or the class Y. So this is the balance that we need to achieve. Now, using a single model like a decision tree or let's say a logistic regression, it is a little, you know, difficult to do that unless and until you're using some advanced techniques, you know, to optimize your models, like, you know, using grid search or something like you know, regularization. In that case, you can you know, deal with these things. But to counter to you know, the case of overfitting and underfitting, that is the variance and the bias, we basically put ensemble models to work. So now let's look at this diagram. This diagram is really intuitive in the sense that it gives you an idea of why the balance between variance and bias or overfitting and underfitting is important. Now, let's look at what we have on the x-axis, right? So on x-axis, what you can see is basically your model complexity, right? So clearly you can see that you have on the x-axis, you have model complexity, and on the y-axis, you have your error. Now, what happens is when your, you know, model complexity is low, so, right, you have not really trained your model highly on the data, and your model complexity is basically your coefficients are not highly trained to look at nonlinear patterns, and you've basically trained a very simple, let's say you've trained a very simple logistic regression model, right? Using the conventional libraries in Python and R, you figure that your error, yeah, initially was low, right? But as you increase the model complexity, your error becomes huge. Right, that is because of the fact that when you're increasing the model complexity, you're increasing the non-linearity in your model. Your model is able to learn more non-linear patterns. But again, the point to be noted here is that it is all on the training data, right? So that is not something that we really want. We want the error at such a point, which is, you know, a perfectly balanced, you know, optimal model complexity, where the error is also not too high and not too low. Now, when the model complexity is really low, your error is low, you increase the model complexity, your variance also increases. That means your model is able to learn nonlinear patterns. And that's the reason your, you know, error also starts increasing at after a certain point of time. So at this point, you still were tolerable. You know, you thought that, okay, this error is not really high, so I can work with it. And once it starts going up, that's where, you know, you should stop. That is a cue to the fact that, you know, this model is not really working good, right? It's just overfitting onto your training data. Now, the next case is of the bias. In bias, as I told you, right, initially when the model complexity is really low, what happens is that the bias is really high, right? So what I mean by that is that your model is not at all able to identify class X from class Y, right? In that case, it is making really high errors, you know, when you're testing it on let's say, your test data. But when you start increasing the model complexity, your bias comes low. And at a point, you know, which is this point, this is the optimum area where, you know, you should be stopping, right? Because you are able to balance the variance and bias trade-off. But if you further increase the model complexity, what you see is that your error reduces. But again, you know, it totally tips off the variance and bias trade-off. Now, what you see here in this black line, right, is something that needs to be achieved, right? You have to find out a point this where, you know, your error is tolerable, right, on the training data. And even if you're using that model, which has let's say not really high errors on the training data. It's basically doing good on the test data at that point of time, right? So if your error on the training data is tolerable, it balances the bias and variance trade-off. It is something that will be the same case for your test data as well. Now, this trade-off management is something that Ensemble models, as I already told you, are really good at. So now let's look at how a typical random forest, which is a bagging method of Ensemble learning, really works, right? So let's jump on to the next slide. And here you can see a random forest, right? So as I told you, random forest is basically combined of two terms, right? One is called the random, the other is called the forest. So we'll understand why this is named random forest and how the intuition is developed behind this. So what I told you before is that when we are talking about Ensemble learning, especially using random forest or a bagging technique, what we are using is the different decision trees, right? So there's a tree one that makes certain predictions, there's a tree two that makes certain predictions, and there's a tree three that makes certain predictions. Now, if I use an individual tree to train a model, this tree will grow as much as it can to fit the curve or to fit the non-linearity in the data. If I'm just using a single tree, right? But in random forest, what I do is basically I contain this tree. I do not let it go, let it get beyond a particular point, right? So let's say I just let the tree go beyond, two levels of bifurcation, and I don't let it go beyond two, three, or maybe four. So a typical decision tree when we are working with to do a classification problem will really go into the depth. So it will probably go to 5, 6, 7. I've even seen trees go up to 15, 16 levels in order to fit the nonlinearity in the data. But again, that's something that we don't want, right? Because then we are overfitting the data onto our training set. So what we essentially want here is that we use multiple trees, right? We essentially use these trees and don't let them grow too much, right? So we'll probably just let them grow to two levels. So that's level one and level two, and stop there, or maybe max three level, as you can see in the two diagrams right beside this one. So in that case, each tree is able to learn, let's say, a small amount of pattern, right? So it's basically learning non-linearity, but it is not learning a highly non-linear model. And what happens is when you're training one decision tree, so one important thing that that is a part of bagging is called bootstrapping. So bootstrapping is actually a term. This term essentially means that whenever you're training each tree in a random forest, you will basically pick up a random sample of the data. You'll randomly sample the whole data. So let's say you have 10 data points in your data, right? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. So you'll randomly sample the data and pick up a bootstrap sample, which is a sample without replacement. Bootstrapping is I think it's with replacement that we're talking about here. So one second, let me just clarify this. Yeah, bootstrapping is when you're doing with replacement. So what happens is, let's say you have observations 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. So let's try and understand it from a very very easy this thing. So I have 10 data points, right? What I'm doing is for each tree, I'm randomly sampling 10 data points from this data set. All right. So what I'm doing is I'm randomly sampling these 10 data points, and what happens is that, so let's say if randomly I sample point number 4, then 5, then 2. Now, since you're doing it with the replacement, what happens is that there is a lot of chance of points being repeated here, right? So 4, 5, 2, 4 can come again, right? Then you have 1, 2 can come again, and 7 and 8, and so on and so forth. You basically create a data set, which is the length of your original data set, but it is a random sample of your original data set. And this sample is sampling with replacement. So due to sampling with replacement, you have a lot of values which are repeated in this data set. Right, so this is typically, let's say, in a generic scenario, when you're working on a problem statement, this data set is let's say tens of thousands of data points, right? But for the sake of simplicity, we're just considering 10 data points so that, you know, it is clear on how the bootstrapping technique actually works. So once you have sampled this data and the sampling is done with replacement, it is called bootstrapping, right? Now this sample, let's call it S1. This sample is essentially fed to a decision tree, right? So let's say this decision tree that you see on the left is the one that is given this data. Now, when you are using this data to sample and provide it to a decision tree, it will make certain predictions on this data. And you know, as we already said, that we have not let this decision tree grow too much. So it will basically be grown till 2 level, and it will learn a pattern which is not highly nonlinear, but it will learn some amount of linearity in the data, right? So that comes with what we call as the decision tree one, right? So now this was your sample one. Now for decision tree two, what you'll take is sample number two. Again, sample number two will be taken with replacement from your original data set, and your values will be sampled again in the same fashion, right? So there will again be a lot of repetition. Generally, when you're doing sampling with replacement, around your 30% of the values are generally repeated in that data set. So that's the rule of a probability that says that, you know, if you do sampling with replacement, 30% of the data will always be repeated in your data set. So you use sample one to train decision tree one, you use sample two to train decision tree two, and you use sample three to train decision tree three to make certain, these guys have outputted what we call as, you know, the classification between X's and zeros, right? Or we can say in this case, what we have seen is the color pink and green. Now, this has been done, right? But there is another very important aspect to this. The reason it is called random forest is because of the fact that you're creating a lot of trees, right? And then using those trees to make an aggregate prediction about a particular data point, right? So that is why the forest part comes into the picture, right? Now, when I'm talking about random, this random plays a very significant role. So if we recall the decision trees, when a decision tree makes a split, so let's say I have my decision tree over here. So when this decision tree is making a split, what it essentially is doing is that, you know, it is using all the variables, right? So all the features in your data set, and figuring out which is the best feature that can segregate your data into two homogeneous clusters, right? So let's say if I'm the case that we'll be talking about today is attrition data set, right? So we'll be figuring out whether a particular employee will stay with the company or whether they will leave the company. That we'll do using a random forest. So in that case, we have some variables. Let's say whether the person got promotion in the last 5 years or not, or, you know, a number of projects that they have worked on, you know, what is the satisfaction level that they have. So these things basically are our variables, right? In simple terms, these guys are our variables that we are talking about. And when you're building a decision tree using these variables, what happens is, essentially, the model will select the best variable, right? So it will select the best variable, let's say the promotion in the last 5 years, to create a split of the original data set. And it will make sure that this variable splits the data set into two very homogeneous, right? I mean, they should be, amongst themselves, they should be very homogeneous in nature, right? So if I'm splitting the data set, let's say I have 10 people that I'm considering, and I'm looking at promotion in the last 5 years, and I'm splitting them in the two sets of homogeneous data, the algorithm makes sure that it splits them in a homogeneous way, right? So that the part one, that is this part, one second, I'll just... So part one, which is your this part, is homogeneous in nature. That means it contains either all yeses or nos, and the part two, which is this part, you know, where you have, let's say, all the no's. That means the people did not leave that company, right? So you can basically divide that data using that variable into two different parts. Now, that is done using different techniques, right? When you're talking about dividing data into two homogeneous sets, that means, either one part of the node will contain all yeses, one part of the node will contain all no's. Now that is decided on the basis of multiple factors, right? So there's something called as a Gini index, there's entropy and information gain, there's log deviance, there's chi-square. So there are multiple methods that are used to find out the best variable which the model can, you know, which split on to create two homogeneous set of nodes. Now, when we're talking about random forest, right? So in case of a decision tree, let's say for the three variables that we talked about, the best variable is picked up, right? But for a random forest, what happens is that you put a constraint on these variables also, right? So you'll say that, no, I don't want all the three variables for a decision tree. I'll only ask two variables, right? So I'll put a constraint and I'll say that only two variables, any two variables, that they can be any two variables, but only two variables will be considered. And these variables are picked up at random, right? So these variables, any two random variables are picked up, and then it is found out whether a split, you know, which one is a better one to perform a split for a particular tree. Now that again helps you avoid the, you know, high variance thing, because you know you're not using the best variable to create two homogeneous sets of data. You're using a variable which is basically, since you're putting a constraint that you're not using all the features or all the variables in your model, you're only using, let's say, 3 or 4 out of 10 features. On the contrary, in a decision tree, you use all the 10 features and select one best feature to do the bifurcation. But as I told you, random forest, you only use, you pick up 3 random features, you put a constraint on how many features do you want to use. And then out of those 3 randomly picked up features, you pick one feature to basically provide a split, right? And that's how you can construct multiple decision trees. Now, all these decision trees are weak learners. Okay, so I think, do we have a question? So is there a criteria, e.g. Gini, to decide between those few random features too? Yeah, definitely. I mean, there's a criteria, right? So if you're talking about Gini index, the Gini index is basically, if your Gini index is lower, it is better. So Gini index is basically, you know, computed using a simple formula. So it's called, the formula is basically P log to the base 2P minus Q log to the base 2Q. Now P and Q are basically your probabilities on success and failure. Or in other words, you can say that the probability that a particular item belongs to class X, and Q is, let's say, the probability that a particular item belongs to class Y. Now when we're talking about entropy, as I told you, should be minimum, you know, it should be at the minimum. Sorry, I'm talking about entropy here, I'm not talking about Gini index. Okay, I was not clear. I mean, when we constrain the features, is there a criteria applied even those limited features? Okay, yeah. I think I got your question wrong. So let's say if you pick 3 features, right, out of 10 features. So for those 3 features, which is the best feature to split on? That will be decided by using Gini index and information gain or entropy or log deviance and chi-square. So there are multiple methods to do that. Now what I've written here is basically the formula for entropy. Now entropy has to be as minimum as possible for a particular variable so that it performs split and combines to 1 second. So I think we have a question here. I'll just take that up. So this is a subset of about, got it. Okay, Chandra Vishwanath, right? I hope your answer is clarified, right? You got what we are trying to say. Thank you. All right. Let's come back to where we were. So what we are saying is that we construct multiple decision trees. Each decision tree is fed a bootstrap sample. That means a sample with replacement. And because of the bootstrapping technique that we're using here, there's a lot of probability of your observations being repeated for a particular decision tree. And each decision tree is capable of learning. Since you're constraining the size of the decision tree that it is growing, you're constraining the number of variables that are used, considered for a split, you're basically limiting the power of one decision tree and making it a weak learner. And when you're using multiple decision trees, putting them together, it essentially gives you a better prediction, which is basically a trade-off between your bias and variance. So that is in crux how a random forest works, right? So I have actually taken another example here, which is a simple one, to explain ensemble model or a random forest in detail. So, you know, it's similar to the one that we looked at before, right? So where we were talking about a person buying a car. So we are talking about whether a person, you know, should buy a flat in Delhi, Mumbai, or Bangalore. So maybe let's say Kiara is a person who's interested in buying a flat. Now, if she listens to a person, so she stays in Mumbai, but she's considering Mumbai, Delhi, and Bangalore for her, you know, investment to stay, you know, and now she definitely will have a bias for a particular city, right? So if she stays in Mumbai, she'll probably be, you know, definitely going for Mumbai. Or if she has her friend circle in Mumbai, she'll definitely prefer in Mumbai. But when she goes to ask different people, she you know, asks random questions, takes different votes from different people, her approach to buying a place will be more holistic in that case, right? She'll not get trapped into basically being driven towards a particular approach. So yeah, I mean, that's how basically random forest or, you know, a decision tree generally works. Now let me see, what do we have here? So this is again, you know, whatever I explained in that slide is basically something that we have shown over here. So this is tree 1, tree 2, and we have till tree n. Okay, so, you know, in general, when you're building decision trees or when you're building a random forest, it's not generally three trees. It's essentially, it can range from 100 to 200 to even 500, right? And how do you decide that? What is the number of trees that you want is something using the out of the bag error, right? So when your out of the bag error basically minimizes, that's where you say that, you know, this is, you know, when you see that the error is not minimizing further. So out of the bag error, typically, you know, when you look at the out of the bag error graph, it looks something like this, right? So you have, sorry for this bad diagram. Okay, let me just extend it a little bit. So let's say on this axis, you have the number of trees, right? So I'm calling it n trees. And on y axis, you have something called as the error, right? So as you increase the number of trees, what happens is that the error starts to fall down. But after a certain point of time, it will get stagnant, right? And it will not, the error will not go down below a certain point, right? And that's, you know, there's a threshold that you can find out, right? So this area, let's say, where, you know, you found out that the error reduction has got stagnant, you'll say that, you know, let's say this is around 50 trees. So, you know, you'll retrain your model using 50 trees instead of, you know, your initial hyperparameter approach where you had taken 100 trees, let's say, to, you know, to build your model. Now, how is out of the bag error calculated, right? So for each decision tree, as I told you, there are few observations which are left out, right? Because there is a repeatability because of the bootstrapping, right? So because of bootstrapping, you have some observations which are repeated, and there are some observations which do not come for a particular decision tree, right? So those observations are picked up and they're ran through each and every decision tree to find out, you know, how basically, you know, how, whether they're able to categorize it correctly or not, right? So that's basically out of the bag error, but it's a much more deeper concept because it's out of the scope here. I cannot explain it in much more detail because of the time constraint. But it essentially, in the crux, what it does is, you know, the observations that are not repeated, right, for a particular decision tree are used. That's the reason they're called out of the bag error, right? Because they were not in each of the bag that you created and fed to a decision tree to make, make predictions from them. So those out of the bag observations are fed through each decision tree. And then, you know, it has figured out whether it made a correct prediction for that particular observation or not. And on the basis of that, you decide what is the optimum number of trees that you should be using to construct a random forest model. Now let's move on to our next slide, which is basically how a random forest algorithm actually works. So I think we have a question here. Okay, do we have to define hyperparameter for each tree? Like tree 1 is splitting part 1, 3, part 2, 5 level, but tree 2 is splitting part 1, 2, part 2, 5. No, Vikas, you don't have to define the hyperparameter for each tree. So whenever you're training a random forest model, what you generally do is, it's basically from sklearn or RF library in R that you can use it. And yeah, let me get back to the slide. And what you're essentially doing there is, you know, you're providing the hyperparameters initially only. And, you know, as a set of arguments to your, you know, model that you're talking about. So it's not for each decision tree, you know, if that clarifies it, yeah, that'll be good. So when you're doing a hyperparameter tuning, you do it for the whole random forest model and not for a single decision tree. All right, that was a good question. So let's move on. So what happens generally is, guys, that, you know, when you're, you know, you're too much into the complexities of things, you basically forget sometimes, you know, some of the very basic things also. So if you have questions like these also, where, you know, you might be a little hesitant in asking, don't worry, just write the question in the chat window, and I'll be glad to answer anything and everything, any questions, any queries that you might have. Okay, so. All right, so this is how random forest actually works, right? So this is something that I defined, that, you know, you use m input variables. So the small m is basically a smaller set of variables than big M. So, and you know, so it's essentially what I've just explained. So now, one thing worth noting is that decision trees, random forests can both be used for classification as well as regression. It's just how you're combining the majority votes of each decision tree is basically, you know, that's different. So for classification problem, you will take majority votes. That means, you know, for a particular observation, let's say three trees say that it belongs to class Y, but seven trees say that it belongs to class X. So you will classify it as X. But for a regression, you will use the average or sometimes also the median of a particular node, right? So that's the only difference between the regression and how classification works for a random forest. Okay, so. Depending upon the value of M, there are slightly different systems, right? So these are basically, you know, this is how you, the number of variables that you select, the subset of the original variables that you select for each decision tree. On the basis of that, there are different types of techniques that are used to construct a random forest. So, you know, there's when you're just considering one variable randomly selected from a set of variables, it's called a random splitter selection. When you're considering M, you know, which is essentially the total number of predictor variables, then it's a Breeman's bagger. If you're considering M, which is much less than the total number of predictors, then it's essentially a random forest that we're looking at. So M is the number of variables. Remember, M is the number of variables that we talked about, which are used for a single decision tree to split and split the data into two homogeneous sets. Okay, now let's move on to the next slide. So this is a visual representation of how a random forest algorithm works. So this is a random subset, as I already told you. It's used to construct a tree, and so on. You know, different trees are constructed using these random subsets, right? Okay. So what are the advantages, right? So we have talked about them also. What are the advantages, right? So it handles the bias and variance trade-off brilliantly. You know, you don't have to worry too much about the missing values, and random forest can both be used for regression as well as classification. And random forest is good for categorical variables also, categorical values, both dependent and independent, right? So these are some of the advantages of random forest. With that, I think, we have finished random forest. Let's move on to the next ensemble technique called boosting. Now, what we do in boosting is basically, again, you know, we are combining multiple weak learners, and we are using these weak learners to make predictions. Okay, so, all right. So Vikas, slide 17, you have some question there. Yeah, Vikas, you have any question on the slide 17? All right, so, okay. Let me just look at that. Can you please elaborate that point? Last point. For categorical values also, right? So what I'm essentially saying is that it can be used, you know, it's the same, the first point again written for the last, you know, repeated in the sense, and written for the last point also. So it can be both used for categorical as well as regression tasks. That's essentially what we are trying to say when we're talking about the last point. So it's just a repetition of the first point actually. All right. So let's move on to the slide number 18, where we are talking about boosting, right? So as I explained earlier, in boosting, what we essentially do is we are trying to, let me answer Chandra's question. Q1, so why do we not prefer to use a random forest? Okay, random forest, you know, it's in a case, see, random forest, it's basically, you know, a hit and trial thing that you try and do, right? I mean, you can use it for a variety of problems. You can use it for both classification as well as the regression. But I don't see not using a random forest for any kind of problem. So let's say if you have an unsupervised learning problem, yeah, in that case, you will not use a random forest, right? Because you don't have a dependent variable. Which you need to predict. So probably in that case, you'll not use a random forest model. You know, you'll use a probably unsupervised learning like a k nearest neighbors, k means, or a hierarchy clustering kind of an activity. So yeah, I think that answers your question. Let me see. All right. So yeah, I mean, anybody else has any questions so far so that we can move on to boosting? All right, I believe there are no questions. So let's go on and talk about boosting now, right? So boosting, when we are saying, is again, you know, it's talking about weak learners, using the weak learners to make, you know, combine their predictions and make a better case. So I'll just explain one of the algorithms, you know, that we typically use in boosting. That algorithm is called AdaBoost, right? So let's say I have a classification problem like this, where I have some pluses, right, and I have some zeros, or let's say minus, let's call them plus and minus, right? So that will be better. So we have some minuses, right? Now in this case, again, it's a very non-linear kind of a pattern that we have to learn. If I use a model which is you know, very good learning non-linear patterns, I'll probably do a good job here. But again, the idea here is to not overfit our data onto the training set, right? So what I'll do is, what AdaBoost does is, right? So what AdaBoost does is, what it'll do is, let's say first it'll classify these set of observations, right? So it is just a weak learner. It is only able to classify two of my pluses correctly out of so many pluses and minuses. Now this model that is able to classify these observations, only two of them, will be, you know, making some errors, right? So what I'll do in the next step is, let's say again I have the same thing, right? I have pluses and I have some minuses here, right? So in the next step, what my model will do is, so first it learned these two, these two pluses, right? In the next step, what it'll do is, it'll learn these two, these two pluses, and again, you know, create a decision boundary so that, again, this is a weak decision boundary, right? It's highly linear in nature. It is not non-linear. It is highly linear in nature. But again, this is a weak learner that is able to learn these two guys, right? So after I've done the two iterations, in the third iteration, again, my data set is like this, right? So what will happen there is, so in the third set of observations, my model will be able to basically learn these guys. Right, now this is worth noting. When I combine all these three approaches together, right? So if I combine the first approach, which was this, I combine the second approach, which was this, and I combine the third approach, right? Which are basically, all three are weak learners. They are very linear in nature. But they're able to do a really great job on this data set, right? They're able to classify this data set really effectively. And, you know, even if there are a few violations here, that's all right. I mean, there could be a case where you have minuses here, a couple of them, over here, or a couple of them over here. But that's, you know, that's the idea behind ensemble learning, that, you know, you do not need to overfit your data onto one data set. But using linear patterns to solve a nonlinear problem is what boosting or ensemble learning will do for you. Now, boosting technique, as I already told you, right? These are, the CL is nothing but your weak learner, and WL is basically your weight that you assign to each learner. So on the basis of the weight that you assign, so let's say if you assign weight 0.25 to this, 0.75 to this, and 0.95 to this. So on the basis of these weights, your model will basically be able to categorize your, when you combine them, these weights will play a significant role in determining, how pluses are separated from all the minuses. So this is how boosting generally works, right? As I told you that it is multiple weak learners, and each weak learner makes an error. On that error, you build another model. Then again, you make some errors because each model that you're building is a weak learner. You again continue this iterative approach till your error minimizes and it balances the bias and variance trade-off. So that's in crux how boosting works, right? The next technique is called stacking. If anybody has any questions on boosting, okay, let me see. Could you explain mathematical intuition behind how XGBoost? Yeah, I mean, I would definitely love to explain this, but looking at the time that we have, I had only AdaBoost on agenda, but if we are doing a separate session on boosting, I'll be glad to get into the details of how XGBoost works. But it essentially, yeah, that's what I was wondering, right? So we'll just quickly go through stacking, and then we'll go to the notebook implementation of how basically random forest works. Yes, with the time we have is still 8, unfortunately, but I would have loved to talk about XGBoost. I'll just give you a slight intuition on how XGBoost works. It is basically using the gradient boosting framework, right? You do a gradient boosting framework and you use boosted trees along with that. So if there's a session on XGBoost sometime, I would really like to get into the depth of it there, but I'm so sorry, I'll not be able to do it right now looking at the time constraint. Okay, so anybody, any questions on this? All right, so let's move on to stacking. Now, stacking is a little different from how bagging and boosting works, right? In bagging and boosting, we were using homogeneous weak learners, right? So either we were using all decision trees, or we were using a single boosted tree to make a prediction, and on the errors we were trying to again build and optimize another model. But when you're talking about stacking, you use heterogeneous weak learners. So there are two steps primarily into stacking. So the first step is where you use weak learners, right? And these weak learners can be heterogeneous in nature. So for a classification problem, it could be SVM, it could be a decision tree, or it could be a logistic regression, or all three, or the two weak learners that we are using. And once you have these heterogeneous weak learners, these weak learners, all the predictions that they make are fed to something called as the meta model. This meta model generally is a neural net. It's from my personal experience that I'm speaking. Whenever we have done stacking in our case, we have followed this approach where we're using weak learners, we're using their predictions and feeding it into a meta model, which is a neural network. Now, when you're training these guys, right? I mean, you have to train it on a single data set, right? But how do you do that? That's a challenging task, right? Because this is a two-step approach. So you use something called as the cross-validation or K-fold cross-validation, where you divide data into two folds. So let's say if I'm doing two-fold cross-validation, which is a model evaluation technique, but here it is used for training the model, right? So if it is two-fold, let's say this in case serves as the input for your weak learners, and this fold serves as the learner for your neural network, and essentially builds your stacking model, which can essentially be used to make predictions in a much more effective way. So stacking models are a hot favorite in competitions like Kaggle. If you go and check out the people who are on the top who are on the top of the leaderboard, if you look at the solutions that they have provided, it's essentially most of the times, I mean, 70 to 80% of the times I've seen that people generally go with stacking models, you know, if it is a supervised learning problem. And stacking is very effective. It's just that it's a little difficult and it's a little complicated to understand and implement. But nevertheless, it's one of the most effective techniques that can be used, right? So here's the diagram that I was talking about. You have initial data set. You create multiple folds. One fold is used to train the weak learners. The other fold is used to evaluate your meta model. The predictions from the L weak learners serve as an input for your meta model, and then you generate predictions using that meta model. All right, so that is in overall brief about how ensemble learning techniques work. Now, if we don't have any questions, we can basically start and open our Jupyter notebooks to see how actually random forest works. All right, so yeah, so I don't think we have any questions so far. So let me just open my notebook. Yeah, I'll just grab a glass of water. Give me a second, guys. I'll just grab a glass of water. All right. Okay, guys. So we'll start with the implementation of random forest in Anaconda, right? So what we need to do is basically import a few libraries that we'll be using here. So I'll start with import pandas as pd and import numpy as np. All right. So meanwhile, when these libraries are getting imported, let's look at what is the case that we're looking at. So I need to import a few more models. So let me just do that first. From sk.cross_validation import train_test_split from sklearn.cross validation import train test split. Okay, why is missing an error? Let me check out the ensemble part. Ensemble sklearn.ensemble import random forest classifier. Okay, so I'm not sure why it is not able to import this module. Let me just Google this. Okay, so let's talk about the problem that we have at hand. Scale on. Yeah, I'm actually using the Anaconda framework, so I will not use the pip, but I'll use the forge from Anaconda. Let me just put this here. So I'll probably have to sklearn. Okay, see, sklearn is already there inside my this thing. Dot model selection. Yeah, I think model selection should do it. All right, yeah, so that works. Thanks to, I think, the person who answered this. Right, so what we are going to do here is we're going to again work with the data set that I had talked about initially, right? But it's a bigger data set. It does not have three variables, but a bigger set of variables. It's the attrition data, right? So it's commonly a data where we are trying to predict if a person stays or leaves the company. It's a typical HR analytics case where using the given data, we'll train a model to figure whether a person will stay with the company or not, right? So I'll just start working with that. So my data set is stored on my desktop. Read underscore CSV. And so I'll just give you a quick glimpse of the data set that we have here. Right, so this is the data set that we have and how many observations we have. It's not a very big data set, but it should suffice the cause that we're trying to solve here, right? So, and it has a lot of variables that we're talking about. So the variables, as you can see, are, you know, ranging from attrition, which is a dependent variable, to, you know, performance related things and, you know, work-life balance and how people have rated that company, right? So now that we have this data set, let's just start with implementing it. All right, so let me get back to the data set, get the link from here. All right, / employee.csv. Okay. All right, so we have the employee data set read. Let's look at the first few data points, right? So head gives you the first five rows of your data and results in all the columns, as you can see here. Now, the first thing that you need to do after you have your data set ready and you know, running in your notebook is to basically look at some of the summary statistics, right? Which will tell you about, let's say, the mean, median, mode for your numeric variables and the frequency, and you know, so on and so forth for all the categorical variables. So what you can do there is use the describe function. So what I'll do is employee.describe. Now, if I don't provide any argument to describe, what it essentially does is just, you know, gives me the numeric variables with all their summary statistics. But I'm going to do include equals to all, so that it shows me the summary stats for the variables which are categorical in nature as well. As you can see, right, so age is basically a numeric variable with mean value 9, standard deviation, mean value 36, standard deviation 9, the minimum is 18, and the maximum is 60. So, you know, so on and so forth, you can look at. So now attrition is basically your dependent variable. It's the target variable that we're trying to predict. You have two different unique values. That is, you have a yes and a no, right? And the first value essentially is no. So I think probably that's the reason it is here. And, you know, different variables have different sort of statistics related to how, you know, they figure in this data set, right? So once we have done that, you need to closely look at all these variables, right? What is the mean, standard deviation, especially, you know, these two figures, so that you can figure out some of the data cleaning techniques or some of the data imputation techniques. You need to figure out if the data is balanced or not. So there are some sanity checks that you need to do. But the data set I have here is, is in a good format to be fed to the model. It just requires a little bit of sanity cleaning, right? So that we need. So let's look at a few of our variables and what are the unique values that we have for them. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to print employee count dot unique. All right, so one second, I have taken the attribute, I've taken the method. Right, so employee count. So the reason I'm doing all this is to show you that there are few redundant variables where we do not have much information. Right, so I'm going to do this for the rest of the variables also, which I have seen are redundant in our case. So employee number is again not much of a use for us because it's just an identifier. Right, then we look at another variable called over 18. Now, all our, the data set that I have, all the people here in this data set are above 18 years of age. So basically, that's the reason, you know, we need to take out this variable also. So employee, EMPLOYEE dot over 18 dot unique. You'll see that all of the values are yes here, right? That's the reason. Now we'll take this variable out also, and then we have the other variable, which is a standard hours. So the standard hours for each variable is 80, and that's the reason we will be just taking out this variable also. So what I'm doing here is just printing and making sure that my data has the assumptions that I'm making here. All right, so now the next step is to drop these variables. So I'll do a employee.drop, and I'll drop my variables employee count, I'll drop employee number, I'll drop over 18, and I will drop the last one, which is standard hours. Right, so okay, we have to specify how we want to delete them. So x is equals to 1 will basically, yeah, got that. So x is equals to 1 essentially is where, you know, you're specifying the columns and you want these columns to be dropped, right? So you mention x is equals to 1 if you want the changes to be done column wise. If you want the changes to be done row wise, you specify x is equals to 0. Right now, let's check if we have any NAs in the data or not, right? So employee dot is NA dot sum will just tell you if your data has any NAs or not, right? So as we can see, this data set is pretty clean. We don't have any NAs here, right? So all the NAs have, there's no NA, that's why the sum of all NAs is 0. Right. Okay. Now the next step here is to basically, you know, assign no's to zeros and yeses to ones. Yeah. So may you please tell once again, why did you drop columns? I was away during that. Okay. So the reason I'm dropping these columns is because of the fact that they have redundant information, right? So employee count is basically for one employee. It's just one. In that column. For employee number is just IDs for each employee, and over 18 is just one variable, yes, because all our employees are about 18 years of age, and standard hours is 80. It's throughout the data set, it's 80. So that's the reason we are dropping these variables, right? So now let's move on to the next step. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to change wherever I have attrition equals to, okay, is there any query that we have here? Remove these columns will help you speed up the process, or also it basically helps to speed up the process, right? I mean, if you take out the unnecessary information that is there in the data set, if you have too much variables, there's something called as a curse of dimensionality that comes into the picture. It's a very common term which is there in statistics. And if you feel that there is some redundant information in a data set, just take it out. Don't worry about that. It won't affect your accuracy or anything. All right, so I'm gonna relabel my all right. So now I'm gonna relabel all my attrition values from no to zero and yes to one. So I'm gonna use the lock for that. Employee dot lock employee attrition is equals to no, comma attrition is equals to zero. So this changes all my attrition values where attrition is equals to no to one. And similarly, I'll do this for attrition yes and change the values to one here. Yes, and let's do this one. Right, so all your attrition where you had no is now zero, and all your attrition where you had yes is one now. Now the next step is to basically let me see. Now what we need to do here is select only the ones where, so see, we, for categorical variables, we need to, in order to work with these models, what we need to do is basically one hot encode them, or, you know, dumbify them. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take some of the variables out, which are all numeric in nature, and leave the rest, which are categorical in nature. I'll turn those categorical variables into dummy variables, and then finally I'll do the modeling bit to proceed with it. Okay, so first I'll pick out the numeric variables in employee num. So I'm gonna do employee dot select d types. Which d types do I want? I want to include only numbers. Include np dot number. I need to put a square bracket here, and columns dot to list. So I'm just changing the columns to a list format. So let's look at our employee num dot head. Right, so all these are numeric variables that I have taken out. So there are around 24 numeric variables that my case has, and I've taken them out. Now I need to calculate the dummies. So I'll create another one where I'm basically taking out all the dummies, and pd.get underscore dummies is the method that you can use to get dummies on the employee data set. I need to employee.select d types. This time I'm gonna take only object data type. So that is categorical is equals to object. And then what we're gonna do is essentially dot columns dot to list. All right, now let's look at our dummy variable values. Right, so dummification is basically assigning ones and zeros, you know, to all the categorical variables, so they are in a numeric format, and we can work with them. Right, now that we have both the dummies and the numeric variables, we can combine them to create a concatenated data set. We'll call that employee underscore combined, and that will be essentially pd.concatenate your two data sets, which is employee underscore num comma employee underscore dummies. All right, so okay, is there sorting using, let me look at employee combine dot head. All right, so there is sorting because non-concatenation. There are a lot of NaN values that I see here. NaN, why is that? Business travel employee head. And okay, again, I'm missing the access part, guys. X is equals to one. Right, this is perfect. All right, now we have everything in the format that we want it to be. All right, great. Now the next part is to basically create the training and the test set, right? So what we're gonna do here is we've already imported the library called train test split. We're gonna basically first, for the train set, what we have to do is drop our attrition column, right? Because that is our target variable. So what we'll do here is for train underscore x is equals to employee combined dot drop ATTRI attrition, and x's will be equal to one. And then we have train underscore y. So what I'm doing here is basically all my x's are stored in train underscore x. That means all my independent variables are in train underscore x, and my dependent variable is going to be in that is the attrition variable is going to be in train underscore y. So let me do that. Combined and I'll have to just take the attrition. Right, so I have my train X and train Y. So this is the train data set that I'm doing here. Now let's just talk about the train test split. All right, so I'm going to do the train test split here. Train test split here. Essentially, what I have done in train X and train Y is used all the data, not just the training data, right? So it's all the data. Now I'll do the train test split in this part. So X underscore train, comma, X underscore test, comma, Y underscore train, comma, Y underscore test is equals to train underscore test split train. So the original data that we have is train X, where we have all our independent variables. Then we have train Y. Then I'm going to use the test size equals to 0.3. That means 30% of the data will be in the test. And I'm going to set a random seed. I'll call it random underscore state is equals to 20. Right. So the reason you do a random seed setting or random state setting is so that you can reproduce the results same way as I've done on my system. The same results will be there on your system also, right? So okay, now that we have this, now let's the final part is to build a model using this, right? So we have already imported the random forest classifier, right? Let's start with creating an object from this library that we imported. So random forest classifier n underscore estimators is equals to 100. Okay, random forest classifier is not defined. Probably I have done spelling mistake here. Let me just go back to where I imported it. Let's take it from here. And let me just put it here. RF is equals to. Right, so yeah, it was a typo. One second. So I think we have, yeah, all right, it was a typo. Right, let's move ahead. So we have created a random forest object which we'll use to fit our model, right? So let's look at that. Now to fit a model, we use a fit procedure, right? So fit and predict are very standard procedures that you use in Python to fit model and make some predictions on it. So let's do that. Let's fit the model using rf.fit. What we have to give it is x underscore train comma y underscore train, because we are fitting the model on the training data set, right? So now these are some of the these are some of the what do you call as hyperparameters that we were talking about, right? So max depth, not specified anything. We are going with the standard default criteria, but you can definitely experiment on your own when you're working on this. The criteria that we have specified here is Gini, you know, the max leaf nodes. Again, you know, this contains the size of the tree. Then you know the number of samples that you want to keep in a leaf, again controls how much weak or how much strong do you want each tree to be. N estimators is basically the number of trees that you want to build. Bootstrap is true. That means bootstrapping the, you know, sampling with replacement will happen by default. And, you know, there are many, many other arguments that you can definitely look out on sklearn and find out, you know, what they actually do and how they help you train your model in a better way, right? So moving on to the next part, what we're going to do is we're going to make some predictions, right? So the predictions are going to be y underscore pred is equals to rf dot predict fit predict method x underscore test. So the predictions are to be made on the test set, and y pred is basically storing the predictions that we have here. Now, in order to analyze our model, you know, whether our model was effective, you know, we need to look at accuracy, precision, and recall, right? So these things come from something called as the confusion matrix, right? So in order to do that, I'll have to import sklearn from sklearn import metrics, right? So there we have the metrics. Now let's print the accuracy of the model. I can hear some noise in the background, guys. If somebody is not muted, please make sure that you're muted so that it is not.
Yeah, I'm muted. One of the participants, I guess, was went on unmute, so I just muted him. Yeah.
All right, great. Thanks, Vijay. So now we have imported the metrics, right? I'm not sure whether you're aware of how to calculate the accuracy, precision, and recall. But these are, again, you know, these are some metrics that are used to, compute the efficiency of the model that you have built. So in this case, we'll just use the metrics library to find out how our model has fared in this case. Okay, all right, great. Let's go ahead. So what we're going to do is print accuracy. Accuracy is metrics.accuracy_score. So this is the method that we're going to use. We have to pass the test file and we have to pass the prediction file to it. And it'll give you the accuracy. So our accuracy of the model is 86%, which is fairly good. You know, it is able to classify around 86% of positives as positives and negatives as negatives. So that's a good thing. Let's look at precision. The precision for our model is accuracy. Sorry, it should be precision score. Precision_score. Y_test. Same metrics, y_pred. The precision is good too. Let's print the recall. Metrics.recall_score, y_test, y_pred. Yeah, the recall is a little bit low here, but yeah, I mean, there's still a lot of work that we need to do here, right? I mean, we can hypertune our parameters by using various techniques such as grid search CV or random search CV. The metrics is with respect to 0 or 1. The result in the metrics is with respect to 0 or 1. Okay. I'm not really sure what you're trying to ask with this. Is with respect to 0 and 1, right? So you have a negative class, you have a positive class, which you already defined. The results are with respect to both the classes, right? So we clearly, I think, defined that somewhere around here. Is asking what the range of values are both. I'm still not clear on what you're trying to ask here. I guess he's asking the range of the values. What do you mean by range? Not sure what you mean by that. This precision or accuracy for attrition, yes or no? Okay, see, if you look at the confusion matrix, so I think it's better that we revise the confusion matrix before we go into this discussion. He's asking about the actual and prediction in the confusion matrix. There's typically a ratio. He means 0 is yes. Yeah, because that's correct. We have already defined that, right? I mean, somewhere around in the above, we have defined 0 as... Okay, I got your question. I think you're trying to ask what is 0 and what is 1, right? So by 0, we mean that the attrition is no. By 1, we mean that the attrition is yes. Right, so yeah, that's how this is defined. I think that answers the question, right? So do you guys need me to revise the confusion matrix? We still have time if you want. I mean, we can do that. Otherwise, I think this is it from my side. I mean, this is a brief introduction to random forest and how to implement it in Python. But yeah, I mean, there's a lot more that you can do on top of it to optimize parameters. As I told you, using a random search CV and a grid search CV. And figure out which is the best model eventually to implement using the hyperparameters that you feel are giving you the best results.
Loveesh, I'll just need a minute. I'm just launching a short poll on the participant screen. They will have a couple of questions only. Guys, right. Just take the poll. It won't take more than 5 seconds. So I'm just launching it here. Here's the poll.
Okay, so
yeah.
I mean, do I need to provide my input on this poll or what is it?
No, it's just for the participants.
All right. Okay. All right.
So once everyone's done, I'll just take the poll off.
All right. Great.
Yeah. And then I guess in the next 5-6 minutes, we can have the Q&A and get it you know, get done with.
Yeah, that sounds great.
Good. Yeah, thank you guys. Thank you for taking the poll. I'm just ending it. Yeah,
I think Amit is asking whether the book and the recording will be available for them somewhere to look at.
Oh, yes. I was about to address that. So we have made a YouTube channel in which all these sessions are there. So the recordings get uploaded on YouTube. And we have made a GitHub link for the speaker's notebook. So if you have to access it, it will be there in the playlist video description. So after today's session gets over, in the next couple of days, we'll upload this video on YouTube on our channel. And in the description, we'll also give the GitHub link of Loveesh's notebook and PPT as well. Okay. I hope that answers your question. Great. Thanks. I'm sharing the link. Just give me a minute.
All right, guys, if you have any questions, I mean, it does not have necessarily to be with respect to Ensemble learning in general, with respect to data science. Any questions, any queries that you might have, I'd be glad to answer them.
I have one question. So
who's
I was
this,
asked,
who's this? Please give up.
This is Manoj.
I'll just request you to please ping your question, because we don't allow actually, you know, conversations in the session. Might decide.
All right. Okay.
Yeah. So please ping your question and Loveesh will be happy to answer it.
Okay. So cross-validation basically is a technique where once you have tested your model, you know, you have trained and you have tested your model, you want to see how much does it, you know, vary if you provide it with different data, right? So in cross-validation, what you do is using the same overall data set that you had used, you break it down into, so let's talk about k-fold cross-validation, let's say. So what you do is you break down the, you take that data set and you basically, let me just open the slide so that I can draw something over here to explain how that actually works. So when we're talking about cross-validation is essentially a model validation technique, right? I mean, it's very effective and, it's used a lot of times to evaluate how your model might behave in unknown circumstances, right? So what you do here is, let's say if you have the data set, right? You have this full data set, which contains a number of data points. If I do a three-fold cross-validation, what I do is I divide this data set in three parts. Right. I mean, this is the whole data set actually. And each, so this is D1, this is D2, this is D3, right? And each fold, what we call is basically containing training and testing values. So you train the model on this data and test it on this data, right? Again, then on the next part, so it is essentially three parts. So these two serve as train and this serves as test. If you're doing a three-fold cross-validation, then for the next model, you use this and this as train and you use this as test. And then you use this as test and the other two folds as train. So this essentially tells you that even if you're, you know, there's a lot of variability in the data, the incoming data or the unseen data, what is the chances of your model, you know, going haywire in its predictions? How much can it really vary when you're talking about, talking about unseen data? So it's basically a validation technique to see if your model might go wrong in production or not, you know, because you don't want to do the things to be really going really bad in case of a production environment, right? Okay, so when you get accuracy and precision of the model, how accurately predict yes and attrition or this overall, yeah. When you're talking about accuracy typically talks about how many times, you know, are the overall observations, how many times did you get yeses right and how many times did you get noes right, right? So if you look at the confusion matrix, looking at the time, we have just a couple of minutes, so I'll quickly draw the confusion matrix here so that there's no more confusion about it. All right, so let me just do this. Okay, so for a confusion matrix, right, you have actual, you have predicted, you have plus, you have minus, you have plus, you have minus, true, positive, false, positive, true, negative, and false, negative. So yeah, I mean, when, sorry, I think I got this wrong. So this is true positive. This is, sorry, false positive should be here. This is true positive, false negative. This is false negative. And sorry, this is true negative and this is false negative. Right, so precision, when you're talking about precision, it's true positive upon true positive plus false positive. When you're talking about recall, recall is true positive upon true positive plus false negative. And your accuracy is true positive plus true negative upon true positive plus true negative plus false positive plus false negative. Right. Okay, so I think, we are on the top of the hour, guys. So yeah, I would have loved to talk about this, but yeah.
Thank you, Loveesh. Thanks for this wonderful session. Thank you, guys.
Log on to GreyAtom's learning platform to unlock more free content. Subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon for regular updates.